People's substance. I just happened last night to watch the BBC. There was a discussion on these very themes about the importance of demographic trends being intentionally seen not just as it's a matter of reducing population, but also looking at how do we encourage and facilitate autonomous, voluntary management and therefore reduction of fertility. And as Professor Lutz rightly said, research now is quite unequivocal on the fact that perhaps the single most important determinant in that is women's empowerment. Education, 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 as one would say. Now, what is the role of volunteerism into that, and in how can it contribute to address global challenges? It's clearly very much the heart of the mandate of an organization like the one that I have the privilege of leading. And I'd like to just make a point, if you allow me, quoting Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. In 2007, on 5th of December, which is when we celebrate International Volunteer Day, he noted how much voluntary action is also essential in our global efforts to address climate change, which poses a serious threat to our ability to reach the Millennium Development Goals. And he went on to say, even governments cannot hope to do so alone. We need people everywhere to volunteer for this challenge and to help communities mitigate and adapt to the effects of climate change. Voluntary action is critical to build domestic solutions for sustainable economic growth and to develop capacities to prepare for and respond to natural disasters. And I would like to call on you as a research community to take this observation really to heart, because your scientific understanding, hard work, research is essential, but you should always bear in mind the voices of those who are directly impacted at the local level and often may even have some of the answers you're looking for. I was talking last night at the reception with some researchers who are doing work with communities in the Amazon area to strive to find sustainable ways of land use. And there again, it's a good example of how do you leverage the knowledge, the indigenous knowledge that often is usually totally uncodified and often so relevant. We should not lose it. In fact, we should value it. And as Minister Liu was saying earlier this morning, building this partnership, ensuring participation, listening to those who, even without having all our fancy doctoral degrees, still have a real life experience of what it means to cope on a daily basis with polluted air, shortage of water, no sanitation, lack of energy sources apart from faraway fuel, biomass, and so on, may also help us find sustainable ways to address some of these issues. I'm very mindful, I've seen Laurie Hunter raising the 5-minute dreaded piece of paper, so I would like to just say a couple more points. When I talk about inclusion, I'm very mindful that processes of inclusion mean consultation, dialogue, and so on. They're very expensive. But I don't think we have ever analyzed the opposite case, and perhaps there is room there for looking into it. How much would it cost not to do it? How much would we lose in knowledge, experience, valuable ideas if we really keep it to a purely academic discussion without ground-proofing, so to speak, what we are planning to do? So I think we need to very intentionally ensure participation, and I do see that engagement, civic engagement, our individuals can provide a means to facilitate this dialogue. Our 8,000 volunteers don't usually sit in nice and air-conditioned offices in capitals. They're out there working with communities, engaging in looking together with the communities for solution to the challenges they are finding. So I would like to encourage attention to youth in this context as the solution and not just the problem. But given that, as is perhaps painfully obvious, I don't qualify for that group anymore, I'd like also to break a spear, so to speak, in favor of those who maybe have silver hair but are still young at heart, and in fact have often proven to be able, especially when it comes towards the end of a professional career, to engage on a voluntary basis and contribute the many years of experience that they have accumulated. Now, before I conclude, I would like to make two more points in that respect. You have in your universities where you're working many young students engaged, committed, interested. Encourage them to continue to remain engaged, to volunteer, and to help you in your research work on a voluntary basis. This is very important. And I think for you too, I'd like to say, volunteering doesn't necessarily mean going out in the wilderness forever. It can be done out of home base. You will find here at the back, where there are a few stands, also one for online volunteering. Online volunteering is a way to engage and contribute without having to leave one's country. And in fact, it's a program that we launched about 9 years ago. It's been so humongously successful that it's almost draining our resources, and we've had close to 1,400 specifically environmental assignments in the course of these years. But that's perhaps not the most important point to make. I was really pleased. Do you remember when the International Panel on Climate Change got the Nobel Prize? We were all very pleased and proud. What I hadn't realized is the work that was undertaken to prepare the report was really done all by volunteer scientists. And that is perhaps the single most important evidence of how individuals' engagement and personal participation can make a difference. So, my call for research. I think it's important to continue to look at the issues of how voluntary engagement can contribute to social inclusion and contribute to economic growth. We have studies ongoing right now, as I speak, with the Johns Hopkins University to value the contribution of volunteers. It doesn't show in the national accounts, and yes, it does contribute nonetheless to economic growth. It's important to continue to research this area to provide convincing, scientifically sound data to promote policy change. I would like also to mention something that we at UNV want to engage in to support what we are all are committed to in terms of protecting our planet and our environment. Every year, as I said, we celebrate International Volunteer Day on 5th of December. So this year we decided we need a special theme. And the special theme for this year has been perhaps inevitably suggested by the fact that the celebration will fall right in the middle of the Copenhagen discussions. So our team will be volunteering for our planet. And I think we will, and in fact I intend to use that opportunity again to raise awareness of the fact that climate change, environmental change, are not just an issue for politicians alone. It touches us all, it touches us very directly. We have a role, each of us, to contribute. Thank you for your attention, and I wish you, your meeting, all success.